attendance. It's lovely to see John from St Helens as well, and Paulette from Sefton, so thank you for being here. Okay, so first of all, any declarations of interest? Start off with you, Jeff.
Mother-in-law's a survivor member of the pension fund.
Daughter's a pension member of the pension fund.
Certainly. Scheme member. My wife's a member of the pension fund, and your wife is a member of the pension fund. John, you're a member of the pension fund. Right, okay. Well, thank you for those declarations. Minutes of our last meeting. Those of you who had the opportunity to look at the minutes, is anyone happy to propose the correct record?
Agreed.
Agreed?
Agreed.
Yeah. Okay. Give me a moment to sign them. Matters arising? No? Okay, we'll carry on then. Right, we've got a presentation about the audit plan. Those who are at the audit and risk management, it was presented here as well. So, over to you.
Yes, thank you, Chair. My name is Grant Patterson, from Grant Horton. I'm the engagement lead for the external audit of the pension fund. What we've got in front of you today is our proposed audit plan for the audit of the pension fund's financial statements. As we just heard, in terms of, I suppose, technical auditing, those charged with governance will be the audit members committee of Wirral Council. However, we bring this here for you to get so you can understand the assurance that we'll be providing our direct auditors to the fund. This is the plan as it stands at the moment. If there are any changes, then we'll bring them back in terms of audit progress report to you at a future meeting. There's no significant real changes to our overall audit approach this year as was compared to last year. And as auditors, what we do look at is a number of significant risks and what as a firm reasonable probable risks. Significant risks are ones where we have to undertake some specific additional work. And similar to last year, we're doing that as management override of control. So that could be how you could how management might misrepresent or look to change the financial statements in terms of looking at performance. It's an inherent risk, it's a risk we have to look at as auditors. It's not saying management are doing this. It's a prescribed risk under auditing standards, and therefore we have to address that significant risk. We normally look in terms of that, how would they change accounts, journals, so our focus is on journal entries. And the other one is around level three investments, as you probably expect, in terms of is there a lot of judgment involved or in terms of estimating their value at year end. So we do identify those areas where we have to take specific forwarding procedures. So those are the two sort of key risks that we're looking at as part of our audit, and they're summarised on page 3, and I will come with a couple more pages in a moment. Materiality, when we do the audit, we set the materiality, we're setting that same benchmark as last year, which was 1% of your net asset value. That's currently around about £87 million, so that's the value has gone up in the year compared to last year, but clearly we'll calculate the final figure when we get the draft financial statements. In terms of where we are on the audit, we're currently on site this month doing our final interim work, and then our final visit will take place in June or July. And the audit fee there is as prescribed by PSAA for this year. On page 4, I'm not going to go into too much detail. We have actually tried to look a bit more deep understanding of your business, what pension fund does. When we did draft this, we didn't know if DCLG or MHCLG, as it is now, was going to bring in a requirement to separate the pension fund annual report from the administrative authority's accounts. That's not going to happen now. They need to change primary legislation. So they're not going to look at doing that in a hurry, but it can't be done through secondary legislation. We're given an update there on progress against Northern Poor, because we see that as maybe a key thing that you should be managing, and you've certainly got papers on the agenda today. It won't specifically impact either so much on that this year's audit, but clearly next year's audit we'll need to follow through those arrangements. On page 5, we've got significant risks, where I said management override control. There is one other prescribed risk under standards in terms of recognising revenue. We're given the control environment you've got at the pension fund, we're able to rebut that one, so because we can predict contributions fairly accurately. Your dividend income from investments is also fairly easy for us to audit, therefore, in terms of material fraud, we're satisfied that we can rebut that. I've already gone through overrides and valuation of investments. On page 7, there was those reasonable probable risks. There's where we said it's likelihood, where we can't actually reduce likelihood material statement to being remote without doing understanding the controls and environment which you've got within the pension fund. So we're taking work along those. So that'd be along contributions, pensions payable, and these are the big figures that are effectively in your fund account. And then the other one is a valuation level 2 investments is correct. And on that one, it's on page 8, we'll look to your custodian wherever possible and test unit values around those elements. So those are the risks that we'll be looking to address as your auditors. There isn't anything significantly more in that. I think I draw your attention to page 12, which is around early close, where the accounts for the council must be they must be prepared by the end of May, and we look to audit, and we must audit and sign the sign-off by the end of July. In relation to the pension fund, you had a dry run last year, and we were successful in doing that, so I don't have an issue from the pension fund perspective if it goes to plan. Clearly, if there's any issues at the council, I'm not saying there would be, then that might, we'd have to address that part of that. I can't issue my opinion before the council's opinion. So we're just really highlighting that it is a challenge for all local government this year to bring that forward. We do remain independent of you. We've not recorded any on page 13, any of our non-audit services. However, if I do get requests in from other auditors for assurances in terms of what we say IAS 19, in other words, employers asking me as a pension fund auditor to give assurance on the controls of the fund, then we normally do pass those costs on to the fund, which then in turn determines whether we choose to pass those on to the employers. So we would discuss those with you when we know when they're coming in. And on that, I'm going to stop and take some questions.
Agenda item is changes or a review of the local government pension scheme update. We'll move on. Again, a regular item. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. This report covers the Treasury's response to the consultation published in November 2016 on the indexation of guaranteed minimum pensions in public service pension schemes. It also details changes at the Department for the Communities and Local Governments. Section 2.1 to 2.2 references previous committee reports, reminding members of the scope of the consultation, along with the proposed solutions to meet government commitments to price protect pensions. Section 2.4 notes that following the reform of the state pension, the government introduced an interim solution, passing the responsibility to index GMPs, the public service pension schemes, for members reaching state pension age from the 6th of April 16 to the 5th of December 2018. The outcome of this consultation extends that interim solution to cover pensioners who reach state pension age before the 6th of April 2021. Section 8 notes the estimated cost to meet this additional liability across the LGPS of between 0.1 and 0.15 billion pounds. The impact will vary for individual employers depending on their membership profile in regard to the number of staff with pre-1988 membership and the level of accrued GMPs. The government will continue to investigate the possibility of converting the GMP values to ordinary scheme benefits as a longer-term solution. As part of the Prime Minister's ministerial reshuffle in January, DCLG has been renamed as the Ministry for Housing, Communities and Local Government, and there's been a change to the Local Government Minister. There's also a new Secretary of State for Education, which may affect the policy to convert all schools to academies and the current review of the impact on LGPS pension funds. The recommendation is that members note the report and are happy to take any questions.
Quite a straightforward report. Any questions of the report? Okay, John.
Just an observation, Chair. I was grateful for the note at 2.10 on page 31. I hadn't quite considered it before, but the change in personnel at the department could actually have down the line implications for funds like ours, because if there are fewer members, because there are fewer schools in the state sector, that will have quite significant, potentially significant implications for schemes like ours. But we'll have to wait and see.
Thanks. Okay, so we're happy to note the recommendations of that report. I'll note it, thank
on the progress that we're making towards implementing the decarbonisation goals that the committee have set. Following on the report last time, it confirms that we're continuing to work in relation to the passive assets of the fund. We got a draft carbon footprint analysis of the fund's listed holdings, and that was discussed at the working party on the 8th of March, and some headlines of the findings are set out under section 2.2, and they confirm that the carbon footprint of the fund is broadly in line with its benchmark. Under section 2.3, we advise that in order to improve the fund's carbon efficiency, it will be necessary to increase the tolerance of tracking error. And under section 2.4, we confirm that we're working with the fund's independent advisors in an options review that pulls all these goals together. Section 3 sets out the relevant risks. Firstly, there is an increased risk, although I'd describe it as a modest risk, of the fund not achieving its targeted returns. And secondly, there will almost certainly be an increase in investment management costs from implementing the policy. Section 13 recommends that members note the progress made towards their decision to allocate a third of the fund's passive equities to a low carbon index, and will continue to bring update reports to this committee in relation to the implementation. Thank you, Chair.
Any questions, members?
Well, that's good. One question, but good, Chair. Yeah, thanks for that being there. A good chat about this topic at the last working group. But could you just give us the latest on the timescale in terms of achieving what we've got there?
Certainly, I think, as we discussed at the working party, there is more information for us to take on board in terms of the carbon footprint report, and we're going to get a formal report done as at the 31st of March this year, which we'll then report on in future. So the 31st of March 18 will be the baseline on which we will report carbon reduction targets going forward. Because of the proposal to go for a more bespoke solution, it's likely that there'll be more of a, because I think last committee I promised something probably by July. I think that's less likely now that we're going for a bespoke solution, but nonetheless I would be disappointed if we hadn't implemented something this year, and I'd hope it would be by the third quarter rather than the fourth quarter this year.
Thanks, Chair. Apologies, I couldn't be here for the earlier meeting where this was discussed, but unfortunately this committee often clashes with my parish council meetings,
yeah.
And I have to make a choice which one I can avoid least frequently. I think this is very important work, and we've had conversations around this table in the past, around this agenda, but there was some recent publication of the reduction in carbon emissions since 1990. Lots of it was achieved in the last 15 years due to national policy changes, and I think that just demonstrates that carbon is a commodity in decline. We're not just doing this because it's a fancy thing to do and it's good PR, even though it is, but it's actually in our members' best interests and in the economy's best interests.
No, I think, to be clear, although the first step is allocate a third of the passive assets, I think very clearly that will only increase in terms of the fund's various assets, its private assets, its property and so on, infrastructure assets, as well as the listed assets.
So happy to know the report. Thank you. Look forward to any future updates. Okay, our next, we're going to put items 6, 7 and 8 together really, with regards to training opportunities, which Peter will introduce again.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Members will be aware that you are encouraged to undertake training and development. So there are 4 items on the agenda. All of them are worthwhile attending. I think in particular the PLSA Local Authority Conference is very useful. It's wide-ranging, but a commitment of 3 days of members' time. So we will send out report on the assumption that approval is given for attendance at the event. We'll send out invitations to members, and if you are able to attend any of them, we'll be very happy to register you.
So we're happy to make approval of the event as a training opportunity.
Yeah.
And so Emma Jones will send out an invitation to those who can make themselves available.
So,
okay, thank you. Agenda item 10, gifts and hospitality to Dominic.
Thank you, Chair. This report provides members with a summary of subsidised business events attended by officers of the fund and details of gifts and hospitality received from January 17 to December 2017. The schedule of declarations can be found in the appendices. Appendix 1 details gifts and hospitality, with Appendix 2 subsidised business events. Section 2 provides the background to this report and details the documents that set out procedures for declarations by officers. Section 13 asks the committee to note the report, with Section 14 detailing the reasons for the recommendation that it's important that the fund has clear guidelines and that officers' activities are subject to review by committee to ensure transparency.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So it is a regular item, obviously very important, and there is an exempt appendices, but any questions otherwise? Happy to note the report. Okay, so a pooling update, regular agenda item now. Peter will come to the bridge.
Yes, thank you, Chair. There are three appendices to the report. The first is minutes of the Shadow Joint Committee meeting on the 5th of December. Secondly, members are asked to consider the report book from the 26th of February 2018 Shadow Joint Committee. And then finally, the Appendix 3 is a copy of a letter from the Minister, as well as providing an update on pooling and the progress made on the various work streams that the Northern Call is undertaking. The particular purpose of the report is to ask committee to consider the extent to which the Northern Call fulfils the four criteria set by government. Government set four criteria in relation to pooling. One is around scale, the second is around governance arrangements, the third is around cost savings, and the fourth is around a capacity to invest in infrastructure. And as the report sets out, the Northern Call has fully fulfilled and delivered on those criteria, and the belief of the Northern Call is that it will continue to deliver cost savings into the future. In relation to the recommendation in the exempt appendix, members are asked to defer any decision on the fulfilment of those criteria in view of the letter from the Minister. I understand that elected members are meeting with the Minister in the middle of April, and perhaps following that meeting or following other clarification, a further recommendation can be brought to this committee. Obviously there's a lot of papers there, a lot of written reports. I'm happy to answer any questions. I would emphasise that pooling will result in fundamental changes to the oversight and management of LGPS assets, which is why it's important that appropriate governance arrangements are put in place. Thank you, Chair.
Okay. Any questions? Okay, so I'll personally report back to this committee from our meeting with the Minister. So I'm happy to accept the recommendation as it is in the exam.
Great.
Thank you. Right, property arrears. Monitoring policy, sorry.
Monitoring.
You can relax. Peter.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Monitoring policy on page 75. The purpose of the report is to seek approval for a revised policy for the monitoring of investment mandates for the fund. The purpose of the monitoring policy we have is to have a framework for measuring the internal and external mandates of the fund, and members will be aware that these are reported to the working parties on a quarterly basis. The fund has undertaken to review the policy from time to time. It was last reviewed in 2012, so a further review has been undertaken. There have been some modest changes to the policy, principally around giving a longer time frame for mandates to perform, which is consistent with the changes in the investment regulations. It also allows for pooling, and the fact that in future there will be the need for reports being made to the pool as well as to the investment monitoring working party. And thirdly, it lengthens the, as I say, the time frame. Sorry, it introduces additional benchmarks for some of our alternative assets, which are measured by an independent external performance manager, but we'll also be measuring them against the more appropriate benchmarks to give further context for the working party to consider the performance of those mandates. So the policy is set out in the exempt part of the agenda, but members are asked to approve the revised policy. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Any questions on this quite straightforward report? Happy to accept the recommendation.
Yes.
Right on, sorry.
Thank you, Chair. The purpose of this report is to request that members agree to the write-off of £21,033.29 of all recoverable rent arrears from the fund's property portfolio. Appendix 1 to the report is a report from CBRE which details property rent arrears and contains exempt information. So if anybody's got any questions on the detail, I'll be happy to answer those in the exempt part of this meeting. CBRE are the managing agents for the fund's property portfolio, and amongst other functions, they have the responsibility for the collection of rent and management of arrears. On an annual basis, following a review with officers of the fund, they produce a report of the uncollectible arrears, which that's contained within the appendix. 8.1 details that the annual property rental income for 2016-17 was £23.5 million. And section 13.1 of the report recommends that Pensions Committee approves the write-off of uncollectible property rental income
£21,043.29.
Thank you, Chair.
Okay, thank you. If we save any detailed questions until the exempt item, John?
Just an observation, Chair, that the write-off represents 0.09% of the property fund's turnover, which is it's a substantial amount of money to an individual, but it's an insubstantial amount of money to an organisation of this size. And it suggests to me that the fund is exceptionally well run and members can take assurance from that. And lots of members around the room will have served on other boards, principally in the housing sector, where write-off, sadly, because of changes to national policy and social security, is significantly higher.
Yeah.
And higher as a percentage as well.
Yeah, thank you. Any other questions? Okay, so thank you for that, Donna. Happy to accept that recommendation. Okay, we have minutes from the working party. Minutes, if we can approve those, and any questions in the exempt item. Happy to approve that. Okay, so we do have some exempt tendencies. So on that basis, on the section 108.4 of the Local Government Act 1972, the public be excluded from meeting during consideration of the following items of business on the grounds that they involve the lengthy disclosure of exempt information as defined by the relevant paragraphs of Part 1 of Schedule 12A as amended to that Act. The public interest test has been applied and the baby's exclusion. So, are we happy to accept that recommendation? Can I then thank Mr. and Mrs. Grace for your attendance tonight and look forward to seeing you again.